Good afternoon once again, everybody. This is Brother Lloyd, and to those who are still keeping the Sabbath, I say Shabbat Shalom. Now, this video I'm about to do is actually a continuation of a video that I started a couple weeks ago titled Your Test in Life, and this is going to be part two, and this is the facing of your temptation. So to continue on, let's go back to James 1 and verse 3, where it read, "Knowing this, that the trying of your faith worketh patience." And so, when a temptation comes, we have to view it as a testing of our faith or lack thereof, because our patience in that is being worked. See, it's not the Father's will that we have failure in temptation, but that we have victory in temptation, because He's already provided the victory for us. We just have to follow through and do our part. But many fail because they are weak in their faith and their trust in Him and in themselves, and they fail. So we have to come away from that and really become devoted to trusting in the Father and our faith. Now, having said this, let me say this, and I want you to pay close attention. As you face your temptation or trials, whether they be the trials of the vicissitudes of life, or whether they be the solicitation to do sin or do evil, when you face these temptations, remember this lesson. James 1:14 reads, "But every man is tempted when he is drawn away of his own lust and enticed." We have to have self-control over our desires and wants. This is the start of what gets most people in trouble. Remember, it is not a sin to be tempted. It's what you do with that temptation that can cause the problem. Now, don't get that desire in your heart when you know that it has the potential to lead you down the wrong path. It's not a sin to be tempted. We just have to not act upon it. Now, if you say, "I had a temptation to do something," then I must be a sinner. No, you weren't. It's not a sin to be tempted. If you say, "I was tempted to tell somebody off," then I must be a sinner. That's not necessarily true. Although, you shouldn't even get to the point of feeling like you should tell someone off, because what you're doing is cultivating something in your heart, in your mind. You're cultivating that, and now you're bordering playing with the enemy, because he can push it right out of you before you know it. So you shouldn't even get to that point. But still, it's not a sin because you didn't do it. Now, if you say, "I had a temptation to commit adultery," was that a sin? Well, no, it's not a sin. But we have to turn away from thoughts and things like that no sooner than they enter our minds. And that's how we have victory over temptations like that. Now, like I keep saying, temptation is not a sin. If it were a sin, then our Savior is a sinner. Yes, I said that. But if you look at Hebrews 4, verse 15, it reads, "For we have not an high priest which cannot be touched with the feeling of our infirmities, but was in all points tempted like as we were, yet without sin." See, He felt what you or I feel because He was human. He was just as much a man as though He were the divine Almighty. But He had all His humaneness and humanity about Him while He was a man, but yet He was still the Almighty. But in His humanity, He was no different than you and I, but yet He went through all this without sin. See, He can sympathize with you or I because He knows what we feel, because He was there. He knows what we face. He knows all of this. And if it's a sin to be tempted, then He was tempted. And that means that He was a sinner as a man, never in His divinity, because we know He never sinned. And we also know that the Father cannot be tempted. So what's even more interesting in this is that we don't even have to rely on our own self to get through this. All we have to do is lean on Him and what He has already provided for us to succeed in these trials of temptation. Remember, these are spiritual battles. And once we fail them spiritually, then physical things become manifest. And secondly, I want to say that testing, trials, and tribulations are not necessarily because of your sin. Sometimes something bad will happen and you will say, "What did I do for this to happen to me? I must have done something terrible. I must have done something that I shouldn't have done." You might lose your job. You might end up in the hospital or what have you. there are a myriad of things that can happen. And the question you start asking is, why are all these things happening to me? See, from that point, what you do is you start doing this introspection of yourself, and you start picking yourself apart, and you try and examine every little thing about yourself. And then when you put it all back together, you're still trying to figure out what you did. But it may not be because you did anything that was wrong. We are all going to go through trials and tests, and we have to understand that the enemy is usually the one applying the obstacles, but the Father may allow him to show the enemy that he can't have victory over us. Remember, there are a lot of things working in our favor. And if you don't understand this, you may get discouraged, because the seeds of doubt and discouragement, they just sprout up in all that ignorance that we have. So we have to come away from this. We have to become knowledgeable and wise in the Father's word, so we lack the ignorance that the enemy counts on that works in his favor. See, our Savior was tested and tempted and tried in all points like we were, but yet without sin. So as you face your temptation, face it with a wholesome attitude. It's all about your attitude. Now, it doesn't mean that you've done something wrong or that you are doing something wrong. The fact is, we are all going to go through trials and tests. Now, the question is, how are you going to face your temptation? Well, I want you to turn to 1 Corinthians 10, verse 13. And I know most of you know this scripture because people use it like a cliche, but yet many still don't even adhere to the soundness of the Father's word or his promise. Now, 10:13 reads like this: "There have no temptation taken you but such as is common to man. But God is faithful, who will not suffer you to be tempted above that ye are able, but will with the temptation also make a way to escape, that ye may be able to bear it." Now, I don't even need to break that down because it's self-explanatory, but here we go anyway. You don't have to go through anything that someone else hasn't been through, and the Father knows your limits and tolerances. He knows what they are and will not challenge you or allow you to be challenged above what you can bear. The word promises that, no matter how you feel about it. See, with that challenge, he will always leave a way to escape harm so you can conquer it. Now, there's no excuse for failing when you're tempted. See, part of the problem is that we're selfish and we want what we want, and we're weak in the word, and we haven't continually strengthened ourselves like we're supposed to. And that's it in a nutshell. Now, I want you to notice the word "but." It's used three times in 1 Corinthians 10, 13. Three times the Father uses the word "but." And it's almost as though he's arguing, or someone's arguing with a parent, and they tell you no about something, and you begin to say, but this, but that, but this, but that. They're arguments against what you want. So the Father took these three buts and three arguments and gave three rebuttals in one scripture to end all the conversation, so we know that what he says is solid. Point number one: if you say or even feel that your temptation is unique, 1 Corinthians 10, 13 has it covered. The Father covered it. "There have no temptation taken you but such as common to man." See, you're not unique. I'm not unique. None of us are unique. And the Father has eliminated that first "but" or that first argument out of the way. Now, the second one is, you may say, "Well, my temptation is too strong. It's too much for me to bear. It's not fair." But God is faithful, who will not suffer you to be tempted above that ye are able. He eliminated that "but." That's a promise. He tells you that. So if you feel like it's too much for you, that's you. The Father says you can tolerate it. You can bear it. See, the Father controls the temptation, even if he allows the administering of it by the enemy. See, he's not going to, like I said, he's not going to let the enemy put more on you than you can bear, even if he's allowing it. Everything that falls upon us goes through the Father. Psalms 103:14 reads like this: "For he knoweth our frame. He remembereth that we are dust." He knows how much we can carry, just like a pickup truck. He knows what the limits are, and he's not going to let those limits be exceeded. And now the third and final argument, you may say, it was just an impossible temptation to overcome. And the word says this, but will with the temptation make a way to escape? There is a way, and we better find it. Whenever we're in these temptations, we better find that way of escape, because the Father has promised that there is a way to escape. Now, if we're not in the Word, if we're not doing what we're supposed to do, we may not find it, but we cannot turn around and blame the Father. He's covered all the arguments. You will fail if you try to do it by yourself and by your own strength. We have to go through Him, just like the enemy's got to go through Him to apply these temptations and trials. See, the Father's plan is simple. His plan is for us to face the trials of life and use what He has given us to succeed and not make excuses. The Father is faithful and is there with us through all of it. He will make a way to escape. And He's covered all the but arguments. And with that, remember, the Heavenly Father doesn't call on us to be successful. He calls on us to be faithful. This is Brother Lloyd. I'm out.